Hello, welcome everyone. For those who don't know me, I'm Jan Svejnar. I'm professor here and I'm also director of the Center on Global Economic Governance at the CIPA, the School of International Public Affairs. We are very honored to have with us today François Villeroy de Gallo, governor of the Banque de France, and joining us, him in particular, as moderator will be Dr. Patricia Mosser, who is, as many of you know, director of the Initiative on Central Banking and Financial Policy here at CIPA, a wonderful new initiative that's taking off in a big way. So we're gathering here as the landscape of the global economy hinges on the aim and quality of economic policies that are implemented in countries around the world. And it obviously also depends on the governance and service delivery of important institutions. And this is particularly true in Europe, where, as you know, the project of the European Union finds itself at a crossroad in many different ways. And Governor Villeroy de Gallo is a leader. He's been a leader on the economic front for a number of years in both the public sector and in the private sector. And in France, literally for decades, from 1990 to 1993, he was European advisor to the Minister of Finance and Prime Minister Pierre Bergoglio. He then held various posts at the French Treasury in Bercy before becoming financial advisor to the permanent representation of France in Brussels. He was chief of staff of the French Minister of the Economy and Finance from 1997 to 2000 and was head of the General Tax Directorate from 2000 to 2003. In 2003, he became the chief executive officer of Cetelem, the consumer credit company of BNP Paribas Group, and served as chief operating officer of BNP Paribas Group, in charge of domestic markets, then of corporate social responsibility. From 2011 until 2015, when the French government then entrusted him with an assignment on investment financing. He was appointed governor of Banque de France by the President of the French Republic on September 30th, 2015, and he's also a member of the Governing Council of the European Central Bank, the ECB, arguably the most powerful institution in Europe at this point. As the governor of Bank of France, he is in an indeed unique position to offer to us his insight and comments on what's happening in terms of the European Central Bank's monetary policy, the challenges in the euro area and EU generally. So it is really my pleasure to welcome Governor Villeroy Gallo here, and why don't we give him a round of applause to start with.
Thank you very much, Jan, for welcoming me. Thank you, Patricia, dear Patricia Mosser, for organizing this event. It's my privilege and honor to be in Colombia for the first time in my life. I didn't study in your CIPA. I understand that among the CIPA students, there might be many future central bankers, so I wish you good luck. And Columbia University is well known as an institution of excellence. What might be less well known is that Columbia has a unique relationship with France and with my institution, the Banque de France. Let me say from the outset one important caveat. I will not comment on the current events in France and on our presidential election. I just would like to remind you that there are two rounds, and this is an important fact, the first one on Sunday and the second one on May the 7th. Especially in moments like these, it's worth looking past the present with a long-term view. A long-term view is much less dangerous. So let me take the long-term view. The Maison Française on the campus was created 100 years ago. Your French department is one of the best in the United States. Moreover, the Banque de France has always valued Columbia academic production, including two concepts that I will use today. The research of Robert Mundell on optimal currency areas, and the research of Mike Woodford on forward guidance. I would say that in Europe, the euro construction is pretty well known, while the ECB monetary policy is often debated. In the United States, it may be the reverse. The monetary policy is often better understood than the euro construction process. So I will deal successively with both issues, euro foundations and ECB monetary policy, before turning in a third part to the future and a call for action in Europe. Let me start with the strong foundations of the euro. These are first and foremost political foundations, and I will insist on this message. As you know, the single currency was officially launched with the Maastricht Treaty 25 years ago, and it was introduced in 1999. But the euro is naturally part of a broader history, the history of Europe and its unique achievement of making the transition from war to peace. As early as 1946, Joseph Müller, who is a not very well-known German, but who was a leading figure in the German resistance to the Nazis, acknowledged that, I quote him, "We need a European currency because countries that share a currency will never be at war." And we should never forget that. The euro has indeed provided us with a strong symbol of unity among European nations. It is true that there is currently some Euroscepticism and a surge of populism. But, and this will be my first slide, a clear majority of euro area citizens support the euro today. This is the case in all member states, including Germany and France. Despite the severe economic downturns that some countries have experienced. From 12 at the start, the number of participating countries has risen to 19 today. 7 additional countries have decided to join the euro since the start, the most recent one being Lithuania, a prosperous country, in 2015. And no country has wanted to leave it. And this also says something. The euro is not a technocratic utopia. It is a political and democratic decision supported 25 years on, with hindsight, by a clear majority of citizens. May I add that outside observers, including sometimes American analysts, probably tend to underestimate this political support. So, our foundations are political, but the European edifice has also sound economic and institutional foundations. Let me come to that now. When reflecting at Columbia University, the first thinker who, as I said, comes to mind is Robert Mandel. It's his theory of optimal currency areas has been used by numerous economists to analyze the European Monetary Union and its chances of success. Mandel himself has remained an ardent supporter of the euro. He put forward a number of theoretical arguments to respond to the critics, including financial integration and capital mobility. I will come back to that. Also recognizing that the EMU, European Monetary Union, remains suboptimal, like to some extent, to be fair, the American Monetary Union in his first research in the 60s. As Mandel said, as late as 2012, quote, "The euro," and this is for me a very good sum up, "the euro is more than just the icing on the cake on the single European market and the European Union. It is the glue that keeps the core of Europe together. Still, an argument frequently heard against the euro is that a currency cannot exist without a state, and you are conscious of this argument. True, the government prerogative of coinage came to be accepted as an essential attribute of sovereignty, tying the state to the money supply. But actually, let us think a bit. The state may manipulate the unit of account to the benefit of its own finances, and we have many examples through the history. For instance, by monetizing the debt, and such manipulations were not always, to say the least, in the interest of citizens. As a result, it seems to me that the key ingredient of monetary stability is not the state, but it's rather the independence and credibility of the issuing institution, the central bank. And this principle is firmly established in the euro area, as well as in French law for the Banque de France. However, one additional word about independence. Safeguarding it requires more than a series of legal provisions. As any political construct, the euro will thrive if and only if the citizens of the euro area member states are convinced that the euro system delivers year after year on its mandate, which is to preserve price stability. This is also the reason why we are subject to accountability rules, requiring regular testimonies to the representation of EU citizens, namely the European Parliament and the national parliaments, and the publication of our minutes and our results. In a nutshell, and this is for me a very strong commitment, independence ensures that the ECB can act in line with its mandate. But accountability ensures that the ECB does act in line with its mandate. So, did we deliver? And this is the most important question. I come to the economic benefits of the euro. The fact is the euro has already delivered material benefits. Let me mention three of them. First, in the line with our mandate, inflation has been kept under control. This directly benefits households' purchasing power and helps build confidence in the value of our currency. Let us take a historical perspective. In the 18 years preceding the introduction of the euro, inflation gradually declined, but remained, as you can see, at 4.6% on average, with major disparities across countries. In the 18 years since the euro, inflation has been much more stable, averaging 1.7%, and this is partly due to the euro. The disparities across countries have narrowed. Second benefit, better control inflation means a lower cost of financing because it reduces risk premia by 1.5%, you see it in blue for France, to 3% or more in the case of Italy. All economic players, and this is a diminution of the spread versus the German Bund. All economic players benefit from lower interest rates, households, companies when they invest, but also governments and hence taxpayers. Spreads may temporarily react to political uncertainties we see today, but remaining in the euro continues to be our best protection against such fluctuations. Third, the euro has helped consolidate the European single market. by eliminating currency fluctuations for corporates. Moreover, the economic size of the euro area and the stability of its currency have enabled the euro to play an important international role. Today, the euro accounts for 20% of international reserves, second only to the dollar. An internationally recognized currency generates economic gains. Financial markets are more attractive to domestic and foreign investors, more liquid, and thus more efficient. But it also carries a political weight. When Mario Draghi speaks at the G20, like in 2 days in Washington, D.C., the whole world listens to Europe attentively, just as when Janet Yellen speaks for the United States. Overall, this list of economic benefits is impressive, particularly when you think that the euro is only 18 years old. More importantly, we have come this far despite the global financial crisis. So let me now turn to monetary policy and how the euro has passed the stress test, so to say, of this crisis. The euro system has had to deploy an innovative and resolute monetary policy strategy, which has helped stabilize the euro area economy and reduce the cost of crisis. Let me briefly recall, and this is a rather complex slide, only for central bank specialists in the audience, let me briefly recall what we have done with more simple words. We had first to face, like the US, the consequences of the collapse of Lehman Brothers. Yet, this was only our first challenge, and you see it after 2008. The second challenge came after 2011, as the Lehman episode paved the way for the euro area sovereign debt crisis and its amplification through the bank sovereign nexus. We notably launched then an unlimited provision of liquidity for a maturity of 3 years at our main refinancing rate in December 11. And then came Mario Draghi's famous speech in July 2012 to do, quote unquote, whatever it takes to preserve the euro. We gave the proof of this commitment through the announcement of our outright monetary transactions program, and the simple announcement was sufficient to alleviate financial market strains. More recently, and I will insist on the right part of the slide, beginning 2014, we had to react to the risk of sliding into deflation, which was due to a combination of factors: the slowdown in global growth, the collapse of commodity prices, and the persistent weakness of domestic demand. And then we implemented a set of vigorous measures, including three main ingredients: asset purchases, forward guidance, both of which are measures that the American Fed also put in place, and negative interest rates. One word about the asset purchase program, or QE. It included first private debt instruments and then also public sector debt from March 2015. And you see it with the strong increase in gray of the size of the ECB balance sheet. Since April 2017 until next December, purchases amount to 60 billion euro per month, having been reduced from 80 billion euro. But the perhaps most unconventional policy is the use of negative interest rates. One more word about this negative interest rate. I emphasize it as the most unconventional measure because for most people, as well as in all economic models that I'm aware of, nominal interest rates are positive. But the ECB's governing council made the bold decision to put in place negative interest rates on the deposit facility rate, DFR, and you see it in June 2014, and to lower them to the current level of minus 0.4% at the start of 2016, in order to further ease monetary and financial conditions. Perhaps precisely because taking such steps was unusual, they helped us convince markets that our commitment to our mandate was very firm. On the other hand, negative interest rates clearly have limitations. They are difficult to accept by households and SMEs, and so impossible in practice to pass through to them. And thus, they are believed by many to deteriorate the profitability of financial intermediation. So we monitor very carefully that maintaining our DFR at its current level doesn't lead banks to reduce their supply of credits. What are the effects of these unconventional ingredients? Our package of non-standard measures has worked and still continues to do so. Inflation is gradually recovering through the Eurozone towards our target of below but close to 2% over the medium term. As of last March, the year-on-year area inflation, euro area inflation, is 1.5%. It was only 0.2% through last year. Financial conditions have eased considerably. I will not comment in detail, but you see on the left part a turning point of credit growth. It was negative throughout the Eurozone black line at the start of 2014. It's now positive of 2% as an average. And if you look at interest rates to non-financial corporation, you see a sharp reduction by 100 basis points and also a sharp reduction in cross-country spread, the most important one being the spread between Italy and France, as the credit conditions are more favorable in France. In addition, the economic recovery is currently firming and broadening. Growth has been steady as I speak for 15 quarters in a row, and 5 million jobs have been created since mid-2013 in the euro area, although unemployment is still too high at 9.6%. The recovery is neither fast or vibrant enough, but it has prevailed in spite of a number of global and domestic shocks. And this is an interesting comparison of domestic forecasts between the euro area in black, United States in blue, and UK in grey. Growth in the euro area was slightly higher than in the United States in 2016 and should not be very far off in 2017. Next steps for monetary policy. What should we do next? It is clear that the current macroeconomic environment does not call for a recalibration. Our current monetary policy stance remains fully appropriate based on current information, as Mario Draghi has stressed, and it should not be adjusted before we see more concrete signs that inflation can be sustained closer to our target. For the future, on the most appropriate way to reduce the intensity of our accommodation when it becomes warranted, two principles should, in my view, guide us: prudence and effectiveness. We need to be prudent because the recovery is still fragile. This amounts to asking whether the adjustment of inflation towards our target of 2% would continue without our monetary stimulus. At present, the ECB's governing council doesn't think it is the case. Underlying inflation without oil and food prices remains below 1% and should, according to our forecast, gradually pick up to 1.8% in 2019, according to the pace of wage increases. Second principle, we need to be effective, in the sense that among our combination of three instruments I mentioned, we should withdraw last the measures that are most needed to secure a sustained adjustment in the path of inflation consistent with our target. We will continue to assess the situation with great pragmatism. There is no predefined split between the doves and the hawks in the governing council, as is sometimes claimed. I'm confident that our future strategy, as the present one, will be the result of a collective discussion and of a cohesive decision. In parallel to this monetary policy, the institutional framework of the euro area has been improved in response to the crisis. Let me mention two great achievements. The first one is the so-called European Stability Mechanism, ESM, introduced in October 2012, which has established a powerful crisis management mechanism for the euro area and an effective lending capacity, impressive one, of 500 billion euros. The second achievement is a banking union. It's a major progress towards further European financial integration. It is now operational based on two pillars: supervision, SSM, single supervision mechanism for all the most Eurozone banks, and resolution, SRM, single resolution mechanism for the banks which could encounter difficulties. Yet, we also have to look at what is still to be done. Further important steps for the banking union are under discussion, with a priority to completing an efficient resolution pillar. Moreover, there are still some issues with certain banks. Let us be clear, in particular regarding non-performing loans in Italy and Portugal. These issues are manageable, but now need to be addressed seriously and quickly. The sooner, the better. That said, we should not judge the European financial sector only on the basis of its difficult cases or those trailing at the rear. Overall, the euro area banking system, and this is especially true for the French banking system, is now far more resilient. In terms of capital, for instance, the so-called Common Equity Tier 1 ratio has risen from less than 7% in 2008 to more than 14% today, so more than doubled since the crisis. In this context, and within the banking union framework, we need to allow more cross-border bank mergers. This will enable banks to better shift savings across national borders towards where investment needs are. And obviously, last word on banking, we should preserve and complete international financial regulation on both sides of the Atlantic. Cooperation on regulation has been a win-win game. Competition on regulation would be a destructive one. Last part, some words about the future and what I call action for Europe. Let me be blunt here. I see the future of the euro area as promising if we act. Obviously, there are challenges today, be they domestic, euroscepticism and unemployment, or global uncertainty in the West, US and UK, as well as in the East. But I am convinced that the answer to the current challenges is not less Europe. That said, there is room for further improvement, for a better Europe. 25 years ago, we spoke in Maastricht of an economic and monetary union. Since then, we have made a success of monetary union. I have stressed it. But we have not been, let us be frank, very effective with regard to economic union. The rather good economic performance in the euro area, on average, still conceals individual heterogeneities. And so, first and foremost, this is a domestic issue. You see the European average in black. This is accumulated growth for the last 3 years on the left and the cumulative employment creation on the right. Some countries, like France and Italy, need to accelerate domestic structural reforms to improve the functioning and flexibility of their economies. And let me be clear, it is in our national interests. We currently have lower economic growth and employment than some of our European neighbors, such as, you see it on the slide, Germany, Spain, and the Netherlands, which have succeeded in carrying out the necessary reforms. So this is good news. Domestic reforms work, even in Europe, and they are compatible with our common European social model. But in order to achieve a better Europe, we need to complete these domestic reforms with what I call the growth triangle. What do I mean with that? The cornerstone is domestic structural reforms. But we need to add two concrete projects. First, to be started immediately, what I call a financing union for investment and innovation. Because the financial crisis has led to a persistent investment crunch at the European level, as partly the same situation we see here in the States. And yet, it is not for lack of resources. One big asset of the euro area is a saving surplus of more than 350 billion euros yearly. That is huge. Several initiatives are already in place. You heard probably about them. The Juncker Plan for public investments, the capital market unions, and the banking union. But they do not deliver sufficient results. It is now necessary to make these three initiatives converge into the financing union. And the equity financing of businesses across European borders must be a priority to foster innovation in Europe. Europe is lagging far behind in this area of equity financing for innovation. Equity financing only represents 67% of the GDP in the euro area, compared with almost double, 125% in the US. The second project, on which we could make progress after the elections, is a collective economic strategy in the euro area. What do I mean with a collective economic strategy? Very simple thing. Growth and employment will be stronger in Europe if we combine more structural reforms where they are necessary, where they are needed, in France and Italy, for instance, and more fiscal or wage support in countries where it is possible, Germany and the Netherlands. In practice, for such a collective game to exist, the euro area needs to overcome the current sense of distrust. It needs what I would call a trust deal. This is why I have proposed, as have others, the creation of a trust institution which could consist of a euro area finance minister. Let me conclude quoting Jacques Delors, who was, as you know, president of the European Commission in the late 80s, early 90s. He used to say that in Europe, we don't just need firefighters, we need architects. The euro system has been a very efficient firefighter during the crisis. I strongly believe it. It is doing its best to contribute within its mandate to building a more dynamic growth path for the euro area through its monetary policy. But monetary policy cannot be the only game in town. It still needs to be complemented with a genuine economic union to achieve the European growth and project. This is now the responsibility of the architects, including the next governments in France and Germany. Thank you for your attention.
So, thank you for that great talk and a lot of food for thought. I'm going to take the moderator's privilege and start and ask you a couple of questions, and then I'll open it up to questions from everybody else. Let me start with monetary policy, since I'm a former central banker. And I'm interested particularly in your views about negative rates. You made the statement that negative rates, you know, come with risks, which they certainly do. And so I'd be curious as to what you see as the greatest risk, and let me give you a scenario under which such risks might evolve. It's not uncommon for coming out of recessions and post-financial crisis periods for recoveries to stall. And my personal view is that the longer that negative interest rates are in place, the increased likelihood is that you will get some negative side effects from them. And so I'm sort of curious as to what your view is about either going more negative, should the recovery slow down significantly, that policy tool versus other policy tools, if the ECB is actually put in that position.
So, dear Patricia, you start with the simplest question. I will not comment much further on monetary policy compared to what I said in my statement. Can I make two additional remarks? First, the ECB was not the one to introduce negative rates first. It's seen as very unusual here. It has not been used by the Federal Reserve, as you know, but it was introduced by some European central banks outside of the Eurozone, be it in Switzerland, Sweden, or Denmark. And as you are conscious, it has been used too in recent years by the Bank of Japan. My second additional comment is that if we decided negative rates, it's because we clearly thought and still think that they are useful. Mm-hmm. We put them to the present level, minus 0.4%, more than 1 year ago, which is already some answer to your question about the future evolution. If you remember, when the Bank of Japan introduced, there was some literature about very negative rates. Some hard figures were quoted. They are not more quoted today. And they are useful because, for several reasons, they give, as I mentioned it, a very strong signal of determination. They give some kind of steepening of the yield curve. And they are also some kind of tax on excessive bank liquidity. So it's a strong incentive to lend. They have limitations. I mentioned them. So we have to make the balance between the positive effects and the limitations. Clearly, if we use them today, and I strongly stress it for our present monetary stance, which is adapted to the present monetary and economic conditions, it's why we think that the economic benefits are more important.
So You mentioned the regulatory standards and the advances that banks and nearly all the advanced economies, but certainly in Europe, have made. It seems to me that the interaction, one of the risks is the interaction between even greater capital requirements, and which are clearly needed for long-run stability, and longer periods of negative interest rates because of the potential impact on profitability that you noted yourself. So that's more a comment than a question, but it, but something that I think that, as you note, is clearly on your radar screen. So I have to ask about your issues about your discussion of macroeconomic stabilization and the perspectives for convergence, given the really pretty large differences that there are at present. And the complicating factor in that, I think, is that, as you noted yourself, and this is true for nearly all the advanced economies, long-run potential growth has taken a very serious hit post-crisis. That's not unusual, by the way. The history of financial crises across decades and countries is that you tend to take a big hit to long-run growth. How much harder is that actually going to be when you think effectively the potential growth rate is a lot lower everywhere and perhaps lowest in the countries that have had the poorer economic performance over the last few years?
This is, as you are aware, a very debated issue, including in this country. So the general...
Absolutely.
I will try to be short. The general view is that we have lost momentum in productivity gains, and so in potential growth. And Bob Gordon's studies, for instance, here in the American economy, you know this famous sentence, I see technological progress everywhere except in economic statistics. It's debated, including in statistics. And there might be some kind of undermeasurement of productivity gains of the new technologies. But it's not the whole story. So I will keep some nuance on that. I think that present figures on productivity gains and potential growth are probably slightly underestimated. And we have done research in the Banque de France. We have organized a colloquy 2 months ago with some very interesting measurements. But the story remains partly true that we see some slowdown. And this is very important for monetary policy. Let me again be very short. Monetary policy can be efficient for fine-tuning the economic cycle and closing the output gap as far as we still have an output gap. But monetary policy is not the situation. You know it clearly, but it's very important also for political deciders, for journalists, etc. Monetary policy is not the adequate tool to increase potential growth. As you are all qualified economists in this audience, you are probably very well aware of this very simple sentence. But it's of utmost importance. When I said at the end that monetary policy cannot be the only game in town, if we have this problem of potential growth slowing down, the solution is more investment and, in some countries, including mine, more reforms. We will not solve this issue of potential growth through a more lax monetary policy or a more lax fiscal policy. It's exactly the same. And I think a common challenge we have, probably on both sides of the Atlantic, is the level of investment. What I quite often call the investment deficit on the investment crunch. If you compare the level of investment at present to GDP, to what we had before the crisis, you are more or less at the same level in the US, more or less, but after years of deficits, so we didn't close the accumulated deficits, and in the Eurozone, we are still below by 3% of GDP. So this is a common challenge, and how can we foster investment in order to increase potential growth? There are many issues. I mentioned domestic reforms. Can I mention a common issue which we have probably, and which is a puzzle in our work at the Banque de France. The very high level of cost of equity we have and the very high expectations on return on investment, to put it in other words. We have reduced the level of interest rates, long-term interest rates, very significantly since the crisis. But cost of equity expectations, expectations on return of investment, have not been reduced at all, be it in the US or in Europe. And the practical consequence, you see it in the US, is that you have a much stronger growth of shares buyback, extra dividends, than of real investment. So this is part of the answer to your question.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I one last question, and this is unfortunately one that probably has a long answer too, but I'll ask for a very precise question. I have to ask a little bit about Brexit. Most of the conversation in the press, though, and even amongst economists, is about risks and potential costs to the UK economy. But that sort of decoupling of economic ties, close economic ties, can't be painful for just one side of the equation. It has to be painful for both sides. I just can't believe that. My question is, as a central banker, looking at the risks that you see out there, the macroeconomic risks, what do you see for the euro area as some of the biggest economic risks? Are there specific sectors or countries or areas where that might end up being of concern to monetary policymakers if they're big enough?
Again, it's a sophisticated question, so I will try to keep it short and simple. First, clearly, Brexit is bad news for everybody. We didn't wish it. It was a choice of British people to be respected, but it remains economic bad news for everybody. Second, it's a worse news for the British economy than for the European one, for a very simple reason, because if you compare the relative size of the two markets, it's a relation of 4 or 5 to 1. Third, and this is a better news in the bad news, the economic effects short-term of the Brexit have been overestimated, and we haven't seen any dampening effect of European growth. We didn't change in any measure our growth forecast for the Eurozone since the Brexit, or to be more precise, if we changed it, it's on the upside. It's not due to Brexit, but due to some acceleration of the economic recovery. And as you know, on the British side, the downwards revision, which happened, was much smaller than feared. It doesn't mean that it will last forever. If we didn't have had yet this economic effect, is for a very simple reason. Brexit didn't happen yet. Didn't happen yet. It has a slowdown effect on investment, but not yet on the economy. Having said that, I will probably not have a very different comment, a central banker, than any other European official. Again, it's a bad news, it was not our choice. But then we have to be consistent with the single market. The single market, it's a balance, it's an addition of free access and common rules. And this is a debate between so-called soft Brexit and hard Brexit. To oversimplify, but it's right. If you say soft Brexit, you say I'm out of the EU, but I accept the rules of the single market, including European Court of Justice. And then you have free access. If it's hard or clean Brexit, you say I don't accept the European rules, then it's very difficult to have free access. Because there can be no cherry picking or no dismantling, separation of access and rules. And this will be probably the rule of the game of the negotiation. So it's not a question of anger, punishment, what we sometimes hear from the European side. It's a very simple question of consistency. The single market is a combination of access and rules. These rules have been built also thanks to a strong British contribution, so our British friends know it still better than we do.
Okay, thank you. So, questions from the floor. Yes, Jan. You get first dibs.
I apologize for jumping the line, but I'll run to class in a minute. So, but Francois, thanks for, you know, it's really informative. It was insightful. It was erudite. And naturally, there'll be a lot of questions. So I have a couple. I realize you don't want to go into the political realm, so I'll call them structural questions. Structural questions. So Mario Draghi.
I will be still more cautious on structural questions.
So we understand, know that Mario Draghi's term at the helm of ECB is maturing. Mm-hmm. And so you've talked about the collective discussion and cohesive decisions. Will these cohesive decisions and collective discussions be in any way affected, and if so, how, by the turnaround at the helm? And second question, unrelated, but related to your future and promising view, which I share in many respects, there has been reignited again the discussion of a possibility of a two-speed Europe. What exactly would you see there, and will it be enhancing your optimism or, in some sense, calming it down?
So the first question is a simpler one. The short answer is no. Mario Draghi has still more than 2.5 years at the presidency. He will remain an excellent and active president till the end, so it doesn't play any role, in our discussion and decision. On your second question about two-speed Europe, this is a more structural, to use your word, a political one. So it's not up to central bankers to decide about that. What I would say as a personal comment is that if we think of various speeds of integration in Europe, we should have two principles. The first one is that it should be possible, but it should remain open. And this is, for me, the key principle. If some countries decide to go further or quicker and others don't want, we should not wait for the last one or the slowest one. But it should remain open. And second command is that the euro area and the euro is probably the best example of the principle I just presented. We are 19 among 27. We have remained an open club. Jan, if I may, you come from a country which belongs to the 8th, the Czech Republic, and it would be, can I convey a personal message with all these excellent witnesses? It would be most welcome, but it's up to the Czech people and the Czech government. No, but to be serious, clearly, if we think of part of Europe going quicker, the Eurozone is the most obvious candidate, including what I mentioned on economic union, financing union, collective economic strategy. We cannot ask two countries which are outside the Eurozone to be part of this collective economic strategy. But if they want to join, as 7 countries did since the start, they are most welcome.
Additional questions? Yeah? Why don't you give your name and your affiliation?
Hi, I'm Frederick Herrmann. I'm a second year student at SEPA. And first of all, as a fellow EU citizen, thank you very much for the talk on financial integration. I surely believe that's important as well. But my question goes actually to monetary policy, but more from a theoretical perspective, since we're not going to comment on what's actually going to happen. We're a couple of SEPA students who are doing our final project on negative interest rates. And I would be interested in your thoughts on, from a theoretical perspective, I'm not necessarily saying that the ECB will cut further, but from a theoretical perspective, what you see as some kind of lower bound for the Eurozone. There's been many numbers thrown out, and especially the Bank of Japan has thrown some more crazy ones out there, but what would you think is the lower bound or the room for the ECB to cut, theoretically?
No, Patricia, I admire. These are very clever questions. No? I don't have political questions. I have only structural ones. I don't have questions on the monetary policy decisions, only theoretical ones, etc. So I will not add much on negative rates. Just saying that your question about the lower bond is a very interesting one. If we had met probably 4 years ago, we would have spoken of a ZLB, zero lower bond. And this was conventional wisdom, saying that interest rates cannot go negative. And now, as you know, everybody speaks of an ELB, effective lower bound. But nobody knows exactly where it is. So it's more gray zone. So I will not give you figures, and you will not be very surprised. I will only remind you what I said a bit earlier, that some figures which were in the financial literature, let's say 18 months ago, don't look very practical, at least today. They are probably theoretical. And this leads me to a second remark. I mentioned pragmatism for the governing council. This is a very interesting balance we have to achieve to keep, so to say, the 2 feet. We must have academic research. We must have theoretical analysis. And I can send to you with Anne Laurier, who is deputy governor with me today. We have in the Banque de France about 150 fellow economists. If some of you want to join the Banque de France as fellow economists, you will be most welcome. And before each governing council, each monetary governing council, we have a meeting with some of them to discuss about the theoretical analysis. This is the first foot. But the second foot is also real economy, so to say, and how we feel things, and how we can incorporate expectations from real actors, be they households or corporates. And I always say that the Banque de France is lucky enough to have the 2 feet, 1 foot on the ground in real economy, and the other feet, which is perhaps our head in the stars, about theory. And this is what I find one of the most interesting aspects of central banking. We need both. Sorry for it was a bit philosophical, but you invited me to this reflection.
Additional questions? Yes.
Très bienvenue à Colombia. You had mentioned, Aktu Baloğlu and the economic policy program in central banking track, originally from Istanbul, Turkey. You had mentioned in your presentation that the implementation of the euro actually lowered the inflation from 4.57% into 1.6% in average. However, the growth of the Eurozone country was about 4 to 5% in average in 1990s to early 2002, I would say. So how should we interpret the results? Like, initially there was a sentiment that the implementation of the euro would result into a more sustainable growth into the Eurozone.
Again, it's a sophisticated question, and I will make a short answer. The first promise of a currency is price stability. Let me be blunt, it's not growth. I think that price stability helps for growth. As you know, there is a different mandate on both sides of the Atlantic. The mandate of the euro system is price stability. The mandate of the Federal Reserve is dual. I'm not sure that in practice it makes such a difference. But on price stability, we delivered. And it helped. We have this debate about European growth and unemployment, clearly. But we shouldn't say, and this was also your question about potential growth, we shouldn't say that monetary policy and currency can achieve everything. This would be an overpromise. We should be very clear about the mandate and accountability. It's why I insisted so much on independence and institutional foundations. Our mandate is price stability, good financing conditions, we delivered. It helps for growth, but it's not sufficient. And so the debate we must have, and let me be clear as an off-the-record comment, it's a debate we have in our democratic debate at present. Is it due to the euro, this low growth and employment, too low growth and employment, or is it due to another factor, namely reforms? It's why I showed the difference between various countries. It's mainly an issue of reforms.
Yes, there's another question out there? Yeah.
Hello, thank you very much. I really like your part about creating a trust institution inside as a means of integration. My question would be, would, for instance, a Parliament of the Eurozone would be an interesting means for restoring trust and to overcome the limitations of intergovernmentalism. And my second question would be, one other path for further integration would be creating a more optimal currency area. That means increasing labor and worker mobility. What would be the role and the part of the European Union be in increasing labor mobility? Thank you very much.
I will express some caution. I mentioned this trust institution and the finance minister. I will express some caution on one bias perhaps we have in the European debate, especially with French voices, that we tend to speak about institutions before speaking about their content and mandate. If you remember what I said, and thank you for your appraisal, if you remember what I said, I spoke of a collective economic strategy. So more reforms in some country, more stimulus in some others. And the list of countries is obvious. For that, we need probably a finance minister or a trust institution. And here, I concur with what you mentioned. This collective economic strategy must have some kind of democratic legitimacy. So is it a Euro part of the European Parliament? Is it a new parliament to be created with finance committees of the European Parliament and national parliaments? This is not up to me to decide. But I insist on the fact that the institution comes not first, but it comes after an objective, a mandate, which is clear, a collective economic strategy for more growth. On your second question about capital and labor mobility, clearly, it would help. And I referred to Robert Mundell's theory. We don't need having studied for years to know that this is an important part of an optimal currency union. The quickest progress we can make is on capital integration. It's why I insisted on financing a union. We had to overcome banking union, because as far as we had separated domestic banking supervision, it was impossible to think about a banking union, a financing union. Now we have the prerequisite. So I would really like the next governments in Europe to accelerate on that. It requires no treaty change. It requires, if I can be blunt, only to overcome some bureaucratic borders between Juncker plan, capital market unions, banking unions. They are in different European towns with different administrations, so we know what bureaucracy is. It's not easy to overcome, but this would be the simplest way to accelerate. Labor mobility is a more delicate issue. It's already the case, if I can give a positive example, for qualified youth with Erasmus, which is a very good example of fostering labor mobility. Just to put a personal conviction on that, I would really like Europe to foster such a program for unqualified youth for apprenticeship. And what I call an Erasmus Pro for professionals, for not qualified young people unemployed in the Southern Europe and getting a chance of receiving a very adequate or strong vocational training in other northern countries and perhaps one job, or coming back with a good qualification. I wouldn't mention great initiatives, but this one would be very efficient.
Yes. Yeah, there was one more here. Oh, okay, there you go.
Thank you for your remarks. My name is Lucas Martin. I'm a student here at SIPA, and I was curious
Which country do you come from?
Oh, originally from Brazil, but I've been in the U.S. for a long time. My question is about the communication strategy once the ECB decides to begin unwinding the programs that it's put in place. Yesterday, we actually heard some remarks from Stan Fisher here at Columbia, and about one of the concerns is to prevent a recurrence of a taper tantrum here in the U.S. when they decide to taper the reinvestment purchases of assets. So I was curious how the ECB thinks about that, how the communication strategy would be with the market once you reach that point. Mm. Thank you.
I will not comment much, but Just to say that first, we are lucky enough to have the US experience. And it's useful. Don't conclude that we will take anything from the US experience, sequencing, ways of communicating, acting, etc. We are European, so we are in a different situation, but it's for us a very useful benchmark. And second, we have to marry, so to say, two values. The first one is credibility, and as you know, it's one of the most important assets for central banks. You say in advance what you will do. This is a principle of forward guidance. And so you give visibility to economic actors. And visibility, for me, is a very important asset because we live in very uncertain times. And I think that one of the roles of central banks, thanks to their independence, thanks to their communication, is to give predictability or visibility to economic actors, credibility. And then I mentioned pragmatism. So you have to look at theory, but also at economic data and real economy, and to say this is now the kind of adaptation we need. That said, as I stress, it's perfectly clear for us that in the current economic conditions, the current monetary state is the adequate way. Mario Draghi said it, but he has the full support of the Governing Council for that. So it's a short answer to your sophisticated questions. It's not a question for today, to put it with other words.
Last question, George.
Bonjour, Monsieur le Gouverneur. George Juju, I teach international banking and finance at the law school.
I know you.
As I go deeper into the risks of financial stability, my focus becomes the public debt of the governments. It's true here. France is close to 100%, Italy 132%. The numbers are staggering. There is only as much, as you said, that monetary policy and even supervision of banks can actually do if the system, the economic system, works on debt. And we just heard yesterday some comments about what eventually maybe the Fed will do in reducing a little bit the amount that they have, the 4.3 trillion. But the reality is the central banks have increased their total balance sheet since the financial crisis by round number $10 trillion. Does that have an influence on the quality of your sleep? Thank you.
The quality of your?
Sleep.
I try to sleep well, but keeping awake. As any central banker, public debt and financial stability are some slightly different issues. So one word on each of them. About financial stability, there was a very important evolution since the crisis, that more or less in each advanced economy, the mandate of the central bank has broadened from price stability to be dealt with monetary policy, but it has been added financial stability, so looking at the price and volume of financial assets, as you know, and to be dealt with macroprudential measures. It would be too long to me to come to this second range of objectives and tools, but it's a very clear duty for the Banque de France, for the ECB, to look at asset prices, asset volumes, and to be ready, if necessary, to implement macroprudential measures. This is not only principles. You can look at the last financial stability review of the ECB published in November, we look very clearly at the evolution of asset prices compared with the historical evolutions, with the economic fundamentals, etc. And our conclusion is that there is no global alert on asset prices. There might be local alerts in such countries or on such sectors, but this is our duty and we are very active on that. It's the same story more or less in this country with the Fed and the so-called FSOC, financial stability
oversight
committee. On your second question of public debt, I agree. It's too high, especially in some countries, be they emerging countries or some European countries like the one you quoted. So I don't think that the solution to our growth and employment challenge in some European countries is an increase of public debt and an increased fiscal stimulus. It's always easy to do during public debates, but it wouldn't be a solution, at least for these countries. The solution is mainly on the reform side, and I showed you this is not theory. It's what we have seen in practice. The countries which have implemented such reforms in Europe have the strongest growth and employment. So reforms do work in Europe, which is good news for us. Having said that, there are some other countries in Europe or worldwide where there is clearly fiscal space, including Germany in Europe. So public debt as such is not an evil. It's a question of level. It's a question of sustainability. I don't know if you look at the IMF World Economic Outlook, the last one to be discussed this week in Washington, D.C. I go tomorrow to Washington, D.C. They try to measure fiscal space in each country. They are a bit accommodative, if I may say it this way. But clearly, if we had the collective economic strategy I mentioned, a combination of reforms in southern countries and fiscal stimulus in northern countries would be an efficient road for Europe. This is why I wouldn't make a general or a global call for fiscal expansion. I would be very cautious on this field.
Lovely. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. It was a wonderful talk. Great mm-hmm. questions, everybody.
May I add a last comment and thanking you again for your warm welcome and your excellent questions. Okay. That I think it's all the more important in the world we live in that we keep this transatlantic dialogue and understanding, yet we don't diverge with the idea that Europe is not efficient on one side and that America is more self-centered on the other side. this could be the two clichés. And I tried to explain to you that the Euro foundations are political and that there is a clear political support for the Euro. But if you look at the average figures for European growth, they are rather good and improving. What we have to do is not forgetting that in each of our countries, including perhaps this one, there is also an important domestic agenda. There are important choices to be made. I mentioned the European social model with less inequalities, more public services. It has perhaps some useful lessons for other countries facing inequalities. But in any way, I find it rather positive news. We still have democratic choices and we still have economic solutions. Thank you.
Thank you. Mm.